of information for the actual implementation of taxation, like, you know, how you are going to implement clause by clause. So it will come out from the executive regulations only. Okay, so basically, and now I will take you through the basic structuring of Oman VAT. Okay, like what are the major things you need to understand from the law for the smooth, you know, to avoid any kind of dispute at a later date. There are certain terminologies which you need to understand very carefully before moving forward. So basically, in VAT is all about, you know, there are certain these few words which I have mentioned herein. Okay, this is somehow, I'll say that a whole soul structure of VAT. First, you need to identify the right classification of transactions. Okay, we'll discuss in the subsequent slide in a bit more detail. Okay, so basically any transaction which you are recording in your books of accounts, it has to be classified in any of the four categories. Okay, it cannot be beyond this. It has to be within this limitation. Like any transactions which you are entering into, it will either be standard rated, zero rated, exempted, or out of scope. Then the question comes up in taxation. The major point is, like, people think of like VAT is just, you know, simply is input and output, or, you know, the 5% tax we have to pay on to our supplier on purchase and the 5% we need to collect on sales. Yes, that's right. But the fact is, the determination of taxable value. This is a big concern. I'll tell you why, because every industry has a different set of transaction. Okay, like if we are into trading, then it seems to be okay. You know that we have a prefix set of transaction. You're buying something and you're selling something at a fixed rate, that's it. But when you go for different industries, like if we talk about hospitality, okay, so if you go to any hotel, you will find they charge various component. Okay, they charge some amount for the rent of the hotel, then they charge service charge, then they charge, even they collect municipal taxes and tourism levy. Okay, so whether while calculating tax, which all component you need to include for the determination of taxable value. Okay, this is a very big concern. So this, no matter in which industry you are, you need to ensure like the amount in which you are calculating tax, that should be the right one. Okay, then the next point comes up for date of supply. Date of supply is something we all know that we have to pay tax, that's for sure. But the point is on which date. Okay, and basically it is from the recording of transaction perspective, like when we are actually supposed to pay tax. Like for example, you especially in case of contracting industry, okay, the contracting industry works in a absolutely different fashion. Like they issue some kind of a PPC, which is called payment certification, okay, which takes sometimes more than 6 months to get certified. Okay, so whether can you defer the tax for more than 6 months, or you are supposed to pay taxes while you have issued the PPC. Okay, so these kind of questions, basically, as I mentioned, these are industry specific things. So depend in which industry you are, you need to find it out. Like you are recording the transaction in the right tax period. Okay. Then comes up for place of supply. Again, because place of supply is another very vital point for determining the fact, like where the tax is supposed to be paid. Okay, because you must be having some kind of cross-border transactions. You purchase from somewhere, you sell it to somewhere. Okay, you must be providing services to outside Oman. Okay, you are selling product outside Oman. You might be having few people who are coming from outside Oman, and they are working for your organization and they are based in Oman. Okay, so there are various permutation combinations in which you know we need to decide the actual place of supply. Okay, and the place of supply is like we need to find out where this transaction will be subject to tax. Okay, then the I think most isolated or the missed out topic, which is deemed supply. Deemed supply is something which we actually don't see, you know, prima facie. You don't realize it. This is not some kind of upfront transactions, but still it is considered as a transaction in VAT. And the maximum companies, you know, they generally missed out this deemed supply, especially in the initial phase. Okay, so in the further sessions or in the further workshops, we'll have some technical sessions where we will explain, you know, these specs in detail. So basically, from the Oman perspective, and I think this is the basic structure everyone needs to, you know, get to know about, especially from, you know, the transaction perspective. These are the broadly some kind of transactions which you will see, you know, which will not attract VAT. Okay. There are certain transactions which are zero rated, and there are certain transactions which are exempted. And why I have included this this only, because if any of your activity, you know, which your company is doing, if it is covered in any of these two categories, okay, like either it is zero rated or it is exempted. So in that case, you have to go through a specific VAT treatment. Okay, like if it is exempted, in that case you don't need to charge VAT, or you cannot actually charge VAT. On the other side, if any of your activity is falling under the criteria of zero rated, so in that case, you know, your transaction will not be subject to tax. And there's a difference in these two transactions. On the output side, when we see in terms of numbers, like if I give you an example of your invoicing for exempted or zero rated, so the fiscal impact, like the monetary valuation, would be almost similar. Okay, like if you are having a supply which is exempted and it is cost to 100 rial, so the invoice will be for 100 rial only. Okay, even the same thing will apply for the zero rated. Invoice for 100 rial, and if the supply is a zero rated supply, so the invoice, the sale invoice, it will be for 100 rial only. But there's a huge difference in terms of the implications. Okay, that I will explain you in subsequent slides. Okay, so there are certain items which they have mentioned. Again, one more thing I would like to clarify you. Like in the law, we say you have to be very specific. Okay, like whatever mentioned here, these are the specific words. We cannot go beyond, you know, anything. Like, for example, they have mentioned financial services. So we need to ensure it first, like which all financial services are covered in this exempted category. Okay, because there are various services which are covered in financials, like the normal banking transactions, insurance, health insurance, life insurance. So based on the UAE or in other countries, like life insurance is considered as a part of financial services, whereas health insurance is not considered, or other insurance are not part of financial services. So in that case, the other insurances will be taxable. Only the life insurance services will be exempted. Okay. So then the second category for exempted is healthcare services. When we are talking about healthcare services, so only the healthcare services, which is, you know, somehow accredited or approved by the regulating authority, only those services will be exempted. Other than that, any services, even you know, it may be any kind of healthcare institutions, that will be subject to tax. I'll give you an example. Like various hospitals, they provide some kind of you know, the valet parking service. Okay, so this valet parking service, based on I'm giving you an example based on Bahrain. Okay, so this valet parking service is not a specific service in terms of healthcare, so it is subject to tax, although it is provided by the healthcare body. Okay. So the same thing is educational services. Only the educational services which are exclusively accredited or approved by the educational bodies, you know, the Ministry of Education and all, only those services will be exempted. Other than that, any services provided, even the educational institutions by, that will be subject to tax. So basically, in the same way, we need to drill down for each and every transaction. Okay. And if any of your transaction is not covered in these two categories, that will be subject to tax for sure. Okay, so now the time is up. So we are coming up for this session for the 9 key aspects. Okay, and believe me, I'm pretty sure like you will find these 9 aspects very, you know, very helpful. And very, you know, I think it will serve the purpose. So basically, when we talk about the implementation of VAT, okay, it starts with, like now, every company need to ensure the first aspect is the fiscal impact, the monetary impact, how VAT is going to affect your organization in terms of money, in terms of, you know, direct cash. So when we talk about the cash flow or this fiscal impact, so there are broadly two types of impact. Is one is a timing impact, which is a cash flow impact. Okay, like for certain time period, you need to add some additional funds to support your business. Other one is the cost impact. Cost impact is like your business, you know, what if you compare the data with the last year from the non-VAT to VAT era, you will find there are some additional cost which you have to incur after implementation of VAT. These are the cost impact. I'll give you an example of this cash flow impact. If you know how you can figure out the numbers. Like if you consider all your data, you know, it remains same. There is no change. The only thing is your debtors, okay, your receivables, it will get inflated by 5% by default. Okay, like now you are issuing an invoice to your customer for 100 riyal. So now your debtors are, valuation is 100 riyal. Okay, but after implementation of VAT, your debtors will be 105. Okay, although the same thing will happen on the purchase side also. Like now you are receiving your invoices from your supplier. Okay, they are charging you 100. So after implementation of VAT, they will charge you 105. But in terms of business, it is always, you know, considered the favorable situation is like your debtor should be always more than your creditor. Okay, so through this aspect, you can figure out like, you know, the additional cash flow required, the differential between. And the other point is, generally for debtors, you know, for the sale, companies provide some kind of credit facility, 90 days or 60 days or even more than that. But in terms of taxation, we don't have any credit facility with the tax authority. Okay, so when your tax is due, you have to pay it, no matter you have collected tax from your client or not. Okay, even though it is pending, but when it is the due date for tax payment, in that case you have to pay it. I'll give you two examples for this tax payment implication. Like after basically with effect from 16th of April, import will be subject to tax. Okay, like any product you are importing, so along with the custom duty, you shall be required to pay VAT in addition to the custom duty. Okay, and to pay VAT to get your goods clear, okay, the due date is before clearance. Okay, so before you get your goods clear from custom, you have to make payment. Okay, so it's a direct cash flow, instant cash flow impact. And the other point is like in Oman, I expect your first tax period Tax period is basically the duration for which we calculate the input and the output. Okay, so anticipate your first tax period will be 2.5 months. Okay, because it is starting from 16th of April, and as per the law, there is a limitation that tax period cannot be less than 1 month. Okay, so it makes a sense to make it a 2.5 month for the first tax period, and then I hope it will be quarterly. Okay, so just example, it is 2.5 months starting from mid of April till May and June. Okay, so all the invoices which you will issue in the month of June, okay, you will provide a credit facility as usual to your customers. Okay, so on this amount, the VAT amount you shall be required to pay to the tax authority by 30th of July. We have a timeline as per the law within the 30 days from the end of the tax period. Okay, however, you will realize your funds from your customers maybe 90 days, 120 days, or even more than that. But the tax amount you shall be required to pay on or before due date, which is 30 days from the end of the tax period. Okay, so now I'll brief you about cost impact. Basically, after implementation of VAT, you shall be required to pay VAT to all the purchase which you will make after the live date of VAT to all your suppliers. Primarily, all commodities will be subject to tax. Okay, so whether you can claim the all amount which you have paid, no, there are certain restrictions. There are certain credit, the VAT amount which you paid to your supplier, and you will not be able to recover. Okay, and this thing will also be clarified in the regulations. Another point is credit lapse due to procedural irregularities. I think this is the main thing everyone need to understand very carefully, because in VAT to claim credit, there is a documentation requirement, and if you miss out the documentation, so even you have a valid credit, but if you don't have a valid documentation, you cannot claim it. Then you need to deploy some additional manpower or dedicated person to look out for your the VAT obligation. The companies may look out for a consulting firm or anything like that. So that's also an additional cash cost impact. Then the penalties, which we always pray, okay, that no one should get penalized, because the penal consequences are really draconian. Okay. Now the second aspect is registration. Registration basically primarily of two types: either it's mandatory or it's voluntary. If it is mandatory, so based on a specific threshold, like if you are crossing a certain amount, which is 1 million Omani rial for the first tax phase, okay, so in that case you have to register on a mandatory basis. And while registering on a mandatory basis, you can just look out even in the initial phase, like whether you can apply for tax group registration or not. Okay, because if you register as a tax group, there are so many inherent advantage. Okay, so but you need to make it ensure that you fulfill the criteria for group registration. Now the interesting part is this voluntary registration. Basically, as per the law, we have four different phases for VAT implementation. And in the first phase, the companies which are having turnover less than 1 million rial, they are not required on a mandatory basis to register for VAT. However, they have an option to register on a voluntary basis. So now the question comes up whether they should register on a voluntary basis or not. So the answer is here. Okay, like any person who is not registered with the tax authority, he cannot claim credit. Okay, and the moment you cannot claim credit, so it will add in your cost. So basically, on a simplified mode, I will explain you, like if you are into B2B model, business to business, in that case somehow it became, you know, mandatory for you in terms of commercial viability, I'm telling you, because otherwise you will not be competitive with the people who are registered, because the people who are registered, they can pass on VAT credit to their customer. However, the person who are not registered, they cannot pass on VAT credit to their customer, and the impact will be that supply will be, you know, a bit more expensive. I have done a calculation, a small calculation. I hope, you know, it will be helpful for you to have a small flavor of it. Like, for example, if you are importing some product for 100 riyal, okay, we have created two scenarios. One, a company is unregistered, and the second, they go for a voluntary registration. In both cases, taxable, this transaction value is same, 100 riyal. Both cases, VAT will be charged at 5% at while, you know, before clearing goods from custom. So the total cost will be, in first case, it will become 105. However, in second case, it remains 100, because the 5, which we pay as a VAT, it will be classified as a VAT input, which is a current asset. Okay. So if you mark up some amount and you figure out your selling price to your client, this is especially for the companies which are into B2B model. Okay. So your selling price will be 115.5. Whereas if you are registered on a voluntary basis, your selling price to the effective selling price to your customer, it will be 110.5. Okay. So definitely the companies will prefer to deal with registered suppliers. Okay. Now the point comes up for the contractual obligations. Okay, even in the law itself, they have clarified this issue. If you are into any industry which is having some kind of a contractual obligations, or, you know, the written form of contracts, so basically either your contracts have a tax clause or it does not have a tax clause. So if you have a tax clause, so in that case, you have a right to recover VAT from your customers. However, if you do not have a tax clause, so again, it comes up in two scenarios. It's B2B or B2C. If it is B2C, then you cannot recover it. Okay. However, if it is B2B, then yes, you do have an option to negotiate with your clients. And I hope if you can convince them, and if you can, you know, make them understand, in that case, you can recover it. And then the other point is, which I always recommend, like especially for the contracting, okay, you need to figure out some a specific clause for the determination of date of supply. Okay, like on which date you will consider the work as done. Okay, so that you can figure out your tax obligation, on in which tax period you are supposed to pay tax, which is somehow missing. I'm pretty sure if you have contract, you can go and check it out. Definitely you will be missing this. Now, this is IT system review. In the IT system review, although, you know, there are so many things which are quite generic in nature, and definitely I think, you know, the companies, even your IT service provider, they will be doing it. But there are certain points which I feel like, you know, which people realize on a later date. These are like, the first thing is, because the VAT is some kind of ongoing process. It's not a one-time activity. So the best thing is you try to maximize your IT system as much as you can. Okay, the things should be automated in the maximum extent possible. The other point is, please do check in your IT system whether do you have a compatibility of issuing an invoice in case of advance. Okay. And not only the issuing of invoice, how you later on, you know, adjust this value. Because especially the companies which are having a software which is linked with the inventory control, in that case, it is a small issue, okay, to deal with the invoicing for advance. Because in VAT, you shall be required to issue an invoice even in case of advance. Okay. The other point is mapping of tax reports with ledgers. Based generally in IT system, tax reports are basically linked with AP and AR module, accounts payable and accounts receivable module. But as an accounting expert, I think we all are very much fond of JV, general vouchers. And whenever we don't find any way out, we post a transaction through JV. Okay. So what I noticed in various IT softwares, the impact of JV was not correlated with the tax report. So please make it sure while doing your IT setup that your tax reports are having even the impact of JV, general voucher. Then another point is, which I feel, because this comes up in the last stage of VAT, which is the assessment stage, or when tax authorities do some kind of audit or scrutiny. This is the reconciliation of VAT return data with financials. Like VAT is having a different parameter, whereas your financials, your accounting books, you record transaction in accounting on a different parameters. So basically the impact will be your VAT return, the data which you will report in your VAT return, it will never tallied with your financials. However, when the tax authorities conduct audit, they will take financials, the audited financials, as a source document. Okay. So just imagine, like, if after 1 year or whenever your audit is done by the tax authorities, and they will ask you to reconcile all your VAT return with the, the financials on a periodic basis. So that's a little bit of hustle. So it's better, like, when we are starting something, we make a note of it and we try to customize something in the system so that we can have a proper reconciliation of the VAT return with the financial data. Okay. Another point is, like, in VAT, basically tax authorities, they require various reports. Okay. The data in various forms required on a time to time basis to conduct audit. So basically, please make it sure, like, your tax report is having all the required fields. Okay, this is another point which I feel very interesting for especially for the GCC market. Like, here we have various family owned businesses in which they have multiple companies working under the same group. So what happens, they are doing n number of unstructured transactions. They issue invoice from one company, collect payment from another company. Issue PO from one company, record stock in another company. Employees are registered in another entity, but they are working for another entity, and they are getting paid or they are getting salary from a different company. Especially the small value import. Okay, they are importing product through logistic companies, and the logistic companies are keeping documents in their name, not in the name of client. Okay, so and we have so many international transactions executed within the territory, like either in UAE, Bahrain, or Oman. However, the transaction executes outside the GCC. Okay. This is another. Some sort of unstructured transactions, which I realize. One more point is the cross transactions. The payment can be set, the adjusted. Like, for example, if you are two entities are working for each other, okay, and they are doing different activities. And in this case, somehow there are some hidden activities which we don't see, but we adjust somehow from the main activity. Okay, in the form of credit note or like that. So after VAT, you can adjust the payment, that's okay, but both activities will be considered as separate, and you shall be required to issue a tax invoice and charge VAT on that. Now, this is, I think, the ultimate crux is the point which I started, classification of supply. to cover your the implementation, you need to break down your transactions in a more detailed manner. Okay, just drill down as in detail as you know as much possible for you. Just break up your transaction, and then you need to figure out the best possible you know the fit out for your transaction. If it is taxable, whether it's standard rated or zero rated, if it is exempted, that's scope you know out of scope. This out of scope will play a very vital role, especially in the initial run. Okay, like all the transactions which are you know before the effective date of implementation, these all will fall under the category of out of scope. Okay, so please make it sure like you break your transactions okay in various component, and then you assign these classifications. Now the transitional provisions, again this is it's a specific clause covered in the law. Okay, this is especially for the April month transaction. No matter whenever you have issued an invoice, no matter if you have already collected the payment, but if the goods are delivered or the service is completed after 16th of April, on or after, okay, in that case you shall be required to charge VAT. This is a clear cut. So don't get confused with the invoicing and the payment or even the contract. No matter if the goods are delivered or services are complete post implementation or post effective date, it will be subject to tax. This is another, I think, a common mistake done by various organizations. Don't compare your implications. Okay, if you do not have the documentation. Okay, like generally companies in the same industry, they compare implications. Like you know, they get to know like other what other company is doing, but they don't have the documentation. Like on the basis of which document they are, you know, treating their transactions, either it's zero rated or exempted or whatever it is. Okay, so because all these transactions which are either exempted or zero rated, these are subject to various you know documentation. So first you need to check it out, like if you are doing any treatment, so whether you are fulfilling the required conditions which are coming out from the regulations, and it is specifically you know some kind of a documentation requirement. The last point is this you need to understand so that you don't miss out anything. This applies even for the trainings which generally people attend. So basically VAT implications is on a broader basis, it is around 70 to 80% is very generic in nature. Okay, it applies to almost every industry, be it any industry or any organization. And then there are certain industry specific implications which are around 10 to 15%. Okay, and at last for each and every company, you know, to make completely ready with the VAT, you need to find out what are your company specific transactions. Okay, because even in the same industry, the different organizations have different set of transactions. So please make it sure like you identify your different transactions. So, you know, as I told you in the previous slide, don't compare with anyone. You need to identify your set of transactions, which are, you know, the specific one. And in the same way, when you do any kind of training or session, you need to figure out the VAT implications for these transactions, because otherwise the substantial things will be covered in the generic segment. Okay, so these are I think I hope this would serve a purpose. Now some points which I feel that you know you should understand or you know consider while doing a VAT implementation or you know setting up the whole structure. The first thing is you need to update the details of the concerned person with the tax authority. Okay, so that you get timely update, reminder for filing of return or any update to, you know, any kind of changes are required. Because what I noticed in various organizations, their details with the tax authorities were not updated. And there were email which was, you know, which belongs to someone else. Their email is not working. Even the contact number was not working. So even the messages or emails sent by the tax authorities, they were not, you know, reached to the right person. So please make it sure your details are updated with the tax authorities. Active participation of all stakeholders. Like generally when it comes to the VAT, so people think out of it's just for the finance team. Okay, and they are the only one to look out for. No, each and everyone has to play their role, like for procurement. So the people who are into procurement, they make it ensure they are dealing with the right person, they are having the right documentation. Okay, salespeople need to ensure, like, you know, they are collecting VAT on the transactions in a right way. Okay, they are submitting the right quotation to their customers. HR need to reconstruct their policies to not to get any kind of VAT cost impact. Okay, one thing I always ensure to each and every organization, please do focus on your employee trainings, because you need to ensure it, like the people who are actually recording the transactions, they are very well versed with the VAT implications. At least they know, you know, what they are supposed to do while recording the transactions. Because if the input data, the transactions recorded in the systems, if it's not right, so no matter you are, you know, getting any kind of consulting, any kind of support from anyone, it will not serve any purpose. It will be a simply like garbage in, garbage out. Okay, so do focus on your employee trainings, figure out their, you know, day-to-day tasks, find out the VAT implications, and, you know, train them. One more advice which I always recommend to people, like consulting firms are for assistance, not for the execution. So as I mentioned in the earlier point, you have to ensure like your data is complete, your data is accurate. Okay, because the consulting firms will be just reviewing your data. Okay, and if the data is not right, so the outcome will not be correct. Okay, and at the last is have a test run before the go live date, especially the companies which are into B2C model, because you know you won't be having a second chance. Once the transaction is done, it's done forever. Okay, so I hope this quick summary is helpful for you. And if now, I think we'll go for the Q&A session. Do we have any questions? I think no.
Thank you, Sachin, for that wonderful session. I hope the session was helpful for the attendees. We'll be having future sessions, industry specific, as well as any detailed session on a particular topics if you care. And we are happy to address any questions. You can simply type it in the chat box, or if anyone raise the hand, I'll be able to make them speak. Thank you. We have two questions here. Let me read one by one. The first one is from an attendee saying, as the law is effective from 16th of April 21, how the VAT would be charged on April month invoice for service industry? Do we need to split the invoice as well, VAT and post-VAT invoice? Yeah, you can unmute.
Okay.
So if any industry who is a service industry, since the VAT effective date is from 16th of April, and how they are supposed to charge the VAT? Do they proportionate the VAT pre-VAT and post-VAT? That's the question.
Okay. So basically, I think even I was intended to cover
this transaction. Okay, and I think this is a very valid question, because the VAT is being implemented from mid of the month, especially for the service industry. Okay, yes, definitely you need to split your invoice, or practically you have to issue two different invoices for the same month. Okay. Because the first 15 days is a non-VAT period. And then from 16th of April, it will be created live. So the transaction or the supply, which is till 15th of April, it will not be subject to VAT. However, the supply or the services, the part of service, which will start from 16th of April until 30th of April, it will be subject to tax. Okay. So yes, I know it is an additional burden on the people. They have to issue two invoices for the same month. One will be a normal invoice, which they are issuing as on today for the first 15 days. And the other one will be a tax invoice, which will be issued from 16th of April till 30th of April.
Okay, so...
Thank you, Sachin. We have another question. How do we claim VAT when we have an international suppliers that are not based in Oman? How do we claim VAT when we have an international supplier that we are that are not based in Oman?
Okay. So
basically for all international transactions, basically there'll be two categories, either it is for service or it is for goods. If it is for goods, it will be coming through the custom channel. Okay, like you need to follow certain procedure with customs to get the goods cleared. Okay, and you have a specific documentation which is called the CDF document, custom declaration form. Okay, and you have a payment receipt for the amount which you have paid for VAT and for customs. So based on these document, you will be able to claim credit. Okay, and now for the service part, for services, please make it sure, because this is, I think, is a very gray area. Services even will be subject to reverse charge mechanism. In that case, you need to record the transaction, you know, as a supplier. Okay, you need to record the VAT impact, which is called the reverse charge mechanism. But like, you will record VAT in your books as a supplier. Okay, but now we have to check it out, like how it will be done, like in various countries, like in Bahrain, you are not supposed to pay in cash. You just need to do some kind of accounting adjustment, book entry. We have to see how it will happen in Oman, whether it will be adjusted through a book entry or we shall be required to pay first and then we claim.
Okay, we have another question. How will VAT affect the bank transactions such as ordinary cash withdrawal and deposit?
Okay, so basically the as I mentioned, in the financial services are exempt. Okay, and I think the substantial bank transactions are will be covered in this financial service category. However, there are certain transactions, like, you know, some kind of a service charge, which bank charge you, either, you know, a credit card fees or something like that, that may be subject to tax. Okay, or like, you know, any kind of processing charges they charge, so that will be subject to tax. But like the ordinary cash withdrawal and deposit, it will not be subject to tax.
Hope that is clear. And we have one question, though it is not particularly related to our session, though I will take it since he has put on the question. What is the requirement if someone wants to be a tax practice or service provider in Oman? I hope it he.
Wow, good.
Okay, I think this is the best question he has asked. They don't need to do anything. They can just reach out to us and we can talk to them, and surely we can find out some way to work together.
Yeah, I have another question. We have a question from one of the attendees. Do we register VAT based on revenue amount for the full year? Or is there any other way to register?
So basically,
to register either on a voluntary basis or on a mandatory basis, you called it, the taxable supplies. Okay, and even in the law itself, they have defined like what will we cover in the definition of taxable supplies. So basically, yes, we have two ways to calculate revenue. Either, it is actual or expected. Actual is something the current month plus the last 11 month. Okay, you need to calculate your actual data. If it crosses or it is more than the threshold limit, either for voluntary or the mandatory registration, in that case you can register. Or you have a forward linkage, which is current month and the expected 11 months. You have some expected numbers, and if it crosses the threshold limit, you can register either on a mandatory or on a voluntary basis.
Okay, so I think we are over by time now. We have exceeded 1 hour of time, and thank you very much for attending this webinar. We hope to see you all in our next webinars. Please be in touch with us for any assistance needed. And thanks again. See you all. Have a good day. Thank you. Thank you.